Kingdom should no longer be exclusively about improving productivity and output from farming, but also about finding a market for what was produced. One consequence was that the ministry provided funding for a new department of agricultural marketing and a chair of agricultural marketing at Newcastle University, or what was to become Newcastle University a few months after the establishment of the chair. This paragraph summarizes the view at that time of what the remit for the new department should be. And I've highlighted the part referring to food consumers because from the onset, the staff in the new department took this as their priority in terms of research. And that, as the chairman has just pointed out, has continued to be the case from then until the present day. And indeed, the first major publication that I was associated with when I moved from the University of Reading to Newcastle was a book called The Food Consumer. This is the structure of this evening's lecture. I'm going to begin by explaining the implications of what is arguably the single most important feature of food consumers from the point of view, at least, of the rest of the economy. And that is the extreme inflexibility of consumption in the face of movements in prices. For most products, not all, but most. I'm then going to go on to show you some of the major changes that have taken place over the last 30 to 40 years in patterns of UK food purchase in this country, drawing attention in particular to a period from roughly the late 1980s to the late 1990s, when there were very rapid, almost dramatic changes in the things that we buy. Third, I'm going to identify some of the ways in which individual food consumers differ from each other and some of the ways in which they are remarkably similar. Then I'm going to go on and talk about the important issue of food consumers and food safety and consumer perceptions and attitudes to food safety and conclude with one or two comments on food consumption and food ethics. So in the first section, I'm looking at the implications of this rigidity of consumption in the face of price movements for first farmers, secondly ministers, and third economic forecasts. In this table, I've used National Food Survey data to identify first a group of products which are fairly sensitive to price changes. Notice the inclusion there of beef. That becomes important later in the lecture. A group which are a bit sensitive to price changes, but frankly not very much. And a group at the bottom where consumption changes hardly at all when prices go up or go down. Here's one consequence of this. This is a record of wheat prices in the United Kingdom during the present decade. You'll see that rather small hill in the middle around 2004. Modest as it is, it involved an increase in the price of wheat from around £60 a tonne to £120 a tonne in a matter of 6 months. The explanation was quite simple. There was a relatively dry summer throughout Europe. Harvests were not as good as usual. There was a shortfall in supplies. This hits inflexible consumption and pushes prices right up. Come the end of 2004 and there's a new harvest and prices go back down as rapidly as they went up. This rather more erratic and dramatic movement in prices of just 2 years ago has much more complex causes. But overall, farming over the last 10 years in this country has faced an erratic and uncertain agricultural market. And part of the reason for that is the inflexibility of food consumption to price changes. This diagram goes back from 1970 to 2009. It's still wheat prices. It's now international wheat prices, and the prices are in real terms. And once you remove the effect of inflation, you'll see that the price rise in the mid-1970s dwarfs what we experienced 2 years ago, even though 2 years ago we thought it was pretty dramatic what was going on. The reaction of the British government to these prices in the mid-1970s, when there was also rapid inflation, was to introduce a product, a policy of food subsidies. And here is a list of the products that were subsidized. There's two important characteristics of these products as far as food consumers are concerned. First, you'll have already spotted, they are generally products which are not, consumption of which is not radically influenced by price changes. And of course, if you've got prices going up because there's a shortfall of supplies, the last thing you want to do is to encourage people to consume more of the products. But more important is a second characteristic of the products listed there, and that is that in general they are bought more by people on low incomes than people on high incomes. And so this policy was really an income subsidy rather than a food subsidy policy. And that was the argument in the article that I've highlighted at the bottom of the screen there, which is probably the first piece of research that I did directly concerned with food consumers. And the contents of the article were quoted extensively in the House of Commons in the debate when the then minister introduced an Act of Parliament extending the powers of the food subsidy programme. The minister, incidentally, was Shirley Williams, who gave a public lecture here just last week. So that's a reaction to high prices, but for most of the last 30 to 40 years, agricultural commodities and food prices have been characterized by declining levels in real terms. And so the next question is, what happens when ministers step in to deal with falling prices rather than rising prices? Here's an example. This is French apples waiting to go into landfill. This is what the Scottish newspaper The Sunday Post thought of it. The article points out that what it called the common market had just destroyed enough fruit and vegetables to keep a city the size of Glasgow going for years. It's careful to say a city the size of Glasgow rather than Glasgow itself. Glaswegians not being renowned as a role model for fruit and vegetable consumption. What happened? This is what happened. Apple production in the then European community, 15 countries, was 50% up in that year compared to normal, and double the quantity harvested in the previous year. And if all those apples had gone onto the market, prices would have fallen to such low levels, ruinously low levels, indeed to levels that would not have even covered the cost of getting there. So you see, sometimes it might make sense to destroy food and remove the peak from the market. And there it is. This is the quantity of apples going into what was called intervention as a consequence of the European policy. Now, perhaps more famous than the Apple Mountain and happening a little earlier was the Butter Mountain. I'm afraid I was only able to find what you might call a scale model of the Butter Mountain, though the caption to this on the internet was indeed Butter Mountain. At that time, production of milk and dairy products in the European Union was some 20 to 30% in excess of production. This surplus, as it became known, was being exported onto world markets with the aid of subsidies, but this was forcing down prices so that they were only about 20% of the level within Europe and were being very expensive. Other ways were found to try and dispose of the dairy product surplus. Some of you may remember free butter for pensioners. When the European Commission, at the end of the year, did a balance sheet to find out how much extra butter had been consumed, they found virtually none. What had happened? Well, of course, the pensioners took the free butter gave it to their family, so then didn't have to buy it. Make the policy work, you've had to take the army into the supermarkets and make them eat it there and then. You could hardly give it away. Well, this leads me on to the third of my examples of the difficulties caused by inflexible food consumption, and it's forecasting agricultural production. I picked a couple of quotes here. This is, forecasting is difficult, especially for the future. This is what Keynes, or roughly what Keynes, said about economic forecasters. And this is my quotation, which I confess I actually made up for the purposes of this lecture this evening. This is milk production in the United Kingdom at that time. You can see shooting up. Little purple dot is a forecast made by a then quango called the National Economic Development Council, made a couple of years earlier. You can see it looks really right on track. Not everybody believed this, and a large agrochemical company came to us and asked us for our view for a marketing forecast of the level of milk production in 10 years' time. I realized that what we needed was not a market forecast, but a policy forecast, because of a conviction that the policy was going to have to do something to get production nearer to consumption. And so what we did was hypothesize some policy alternatives, estimate the impact that they would have on milk production, and then we did what's known as a Delphi survey of experts throughout Europe. And their job was to attach probabilities to the different policy outcomes. We used that information then to make a forecast of milk production in the UK and in Europe. And that's Europe. Europe, just 10 countries. And of course, if you give forecasts, you don't go back to them and publicize them unless they're successful ones. Well, this was spectacularly successful in terms of two alternatives we gave there, and actual production in 10 years' time turned out to be a right bang in the middle of that particular forecast. Not quite so good as far as the UK is concerned. We underestimated the extent to which the policy would rein back milk production in this country, but still better than made by the economists in the National Economic Development Council. So, on to part two. Changing patterns of UK consumption. This is milk, liquid milk. And you can see a major change there from purchases of full-fat whole milk switching to mainly other is skim milk, low-fat milk. The thing I want to draw to your attention is that period in the middle of the diagram where you can see a rapid change taking place followed by, for the last 10 to 15 years, much more stability. This is characteristic of a lot of food purchases in this country. There was a period of intense change, which for some reason has been little commented upon.